The next speaker is Roger Sharp. And Roger, if you know Roger Sharp, you know Roger has a lot of very unique characteristics. Now, I did not say good, but I did say he has a lot of very unique characteristics. He has the distinction of being the only person that has ever spoken at every single one of the migration conferences. None of us have, except for Roger, and you're about to find out why. It mostly has to do with the fact that he has no shame, and he has no filter that runs between his brain and his mouth. So with that, I'd like to introduce Roger Sharp. You're welcome.
Okay. Thanks, Dale, for warming up the audience. Dale and I obviously grew up in different parts of the country. He said people took us out and taught us how to skid cars. We just hotwired the family roadster and learned for ourselves. So, but the objective was probably the same. Let's look at what we're going to talk about today, because I can't really remember. The news. Not much going on in the news these days, so can't talk about that. Except in 2 weeks, we're going to find out the answer to the question, will Bob Dylan accept his Nobel Prize? You all may choose to remember 2016 as the inextinguishable dumpster fire of a presidential election. I, however, am going to celebrate the fact that somebody who can't sing is going to win a Nobel Prize for poetry. And he's one of my heroes because even though Bob Dylan really can't sing, he's been a fantastic entertainer, which only proves that if you really don't have to be able to fly to be a fantastic flight instructor. So that gets me back on point, and I only have 30 minutes because we're running out of time, and I don't want to get in the way of your first bathroom break. So I want to talk about flight training, and we all know it's the best job in the world except for the three little things, the airplanes, the customers, and the instructors. Now, don't get me started on the first two. We're just going to talk about the instructors for a little bit. We're going to talk about their technical competence and their customer service skills, both of which I am going to give you an argument that they may not be where they should be. Now, a long time ago, in a land far away, an aircraft manufacturing company put together a group of people. And these people were knowledgeable and energetic and extremely good-looking. And they were put together to help the Cessna, help pilot centers. I can't say the word Cessna because, well, I'll announce it here. In 2020, I am running for president of the United States of America. Wait. I'm doing this for three reasons. One, I have too much time on my hand. The second is you don't have to have any qualifications. But more importantly, there is nothing that can absolutely disqualify you from being president. So I'm going to be there. So where did this group of people come from? All right, so we had this group of people, and it was organized in this company. First, it started out under sales, then it went to production, then it went to marketing, then it went back under sales, and then it went gone. And the real problem with the organization was not what they were doing for the flight school owners. Many of you went to some of those presentations. The fact was that all these well-meaning managers of these particular organizations didn't understand that pillared organizations never really worked towards the common goal, which is branding of the company and getting the product out the door. They try, but they can't do it because they're too busy running their own little organization. That's why that organization doesn't exist anymore. And I consider that, from a management point of view, kind of a sophomoric attitude. And, pardon me for the English lecture this morning, sophomoric comes from the Greek, from the two words sophos, which means, okay, wise, and moros, which means, okay, good, fool. So literally, wise fool. That'll come up later in the test, so pay attention. Now, all these schools were gathering one evening in Wichita, and as it turns out, it gets cold in Wichita. I was supposed to give a presentation on the implications of tax, buying new airplanes and putting them in flight schools. I really wanted to be talking about flight instructors, but I didn't. And the reason I didn't is because it's really hard to talk about flight instructors. Even though we realize that these are the people who are the least invested in your company, yet, because they have the most direct contact time with your customers, actually drive the success of your company, and therefore your success. So, we all know they're touch-and-go employees. It just depends on how long. Back in the days when all you had to have was 250 hours, a commercial pilot certificate, vision in one eye, and half a pulse, you could be hired by fly-by-night airlines in your dream to get up to eventually to the big boys. It seemed a pretty monumental task, and I was pondering how I was going to ever be able to do that. And I didn't think I was going to be able to until I met Skippy. And Skippy taught me all about deer urine. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I think, or other stuff too. So, it was cold, and I didn't have a sweater because we come from the southern part of the Republic of Texas. And I said, well, I'll go get a sweater, and right near where I was staying, they had this very large outdoor store. And they weren't common back in the day, now they're all over the place, Cabela's, Pro Bass, but this one was a little bit different. This giant outdoor store, and I walked in, and I was a little bit surprised. This store was about the size of a super Walmart, and it was just full of aisles and aisles and aisles of mostly guns, ammunition, and edged weapons. I had never actually been in a store this big. I mean, they had so many guns in there that they could equip most of the, you know, Central European armies easily. And I came at a bad time because there weren't a whole lot of customers in the store, but what there were, a lot of people who worked in the store, and they all had an orange and tan shooting vest. Now, I assume that was so that you would know that they were employees when they came up and harassed you, but I looked and there's nobody in the store and all I see is a sea of orange and tan shooting vests. Now, I don't like to shop. I'm a hunter. I wanted to hunt this sweater, kill it, get out the door, go home. But I couldn't get anywhere without somebody walking up, and you could see them coming over the aisles. And you try and move away, but now they change course. And they show up in front of you and say, can I help you with something today, sir? Or can I answer any questions, sir? Oh, no thanks, I'm just looking for sweaters. I'll walk you over there. No, that's okay. I can walk myself over there. But no, they would do it. Everywhere I turned around, the sweaters. So it was going to be a long day for me. So I found my sweater, I hunted it, and then I realized I had a whole bunch of time before I was supposed to meet somebody for pre-topic drinks, which is really what's missing this morning, isn't it? We should really do this after we're all a little bit liquored up, like in the evening, but we'll change the schedule next time. So we walk in, and I hear this noise. I hear this, and I'm wondering what this noise is. And I walk in, and I see this glass door, and there's an archery range inside the store. So I open the door, walk in, and here are three people who are practicing their archery. And they are dressed head to toe in camouflage gear. I mean everything, the pants, the jackets, the gloves, the hat, the face net. And they are shooting these bows, which I really had, it's been a long time since I shot a bow at that point. And the ones I remember when I was a kid, if you were shooting at something, you know, from here to this light, you had to point it up here. They actually had to point the targets on an angle, if you remember, because that's the only way the gravity would allow them to stick, because if you shot it straight, it would just go right into the dirt. Well, these guys are shooting stuff. You can't see the arrow. All you hear is this. And they're shooting at these little woodland creature, 3D models, life-size deer models. And they're actually practicing. They're behind a little thing, and they get up really slowly. They draw really slowly. Thing goes downrange into this little deer. And the deer's not doing anything. It's just sitting there. You know, I guess it's a Kansas deer. It's sitting there out in the field with its head down, nibbling it on some grass. Now, I grew up in Jersey, like I said. The deer in Jersey are a little different. You know, you drive by at night, the light shines on them. You know, they're leaning up against a tree. Leather jacket, smoking a cigarette. Shine the light on them. You know, clearly, clearly a different set of animals at that point. So they're doing this, and I'm watching for a while, and somebody sneaks up behind me, scares the shit out of me, I mean, and it says, can I help you with something? Oh, geez, no, that's fine. And he goes, yeah, we have all this time. Would you like to try to shoot? And I turned around and I said, no thanks. Clearly I'm not properly attired. And I walked out the door. And as I was walking out, now I want to get out of the store really badly because I can see this sea of orange vests coming. And I'm walking pretty quickly and all of a sudden, boom, there was Skippy. And I don't even know where he came from. I swear to God. There was a long aisle, nobody in it when I started. Boom, he apparates right in front of me. He's this howdy-doody looking kid. You know, he's probably 18. He looks all of about 14. Tall, skinny, crop of red hair, acne to match, howdy-doody looking kid. And he says, can I help you with something today? He had that uncomfortably not yet turned voice that teenage boys often have and have to go through embarrassingly. And I would have just said, no, thank you. But two things. He was blocking my way, and I noticed that I was standing entirely in an aisle made up of deer urine. So I said, okay, I've had enough. I'll play. I said, well, yes, I have a question. And I looked at his name tag, and I forget what it was, but we'll call him Skippy. Okay, Skippy, I have a question. I really don't know much about deer urine. Perhaps you could help me out, you know, kind of tell me about this stuff. Okay, I thought that would be enough. And to tell you the truth, this kid did the best job of selling something I have ever seen in my life. Not only did he break it down for me that this vast aisle of deer urine had different kinds. There's buck urine and there's doe urine and there's doe and heat urine. I don't know how they get that stuff, but they have all this kind of stuff. And he's breaking it down and he's talking about features and benefits and he's picking up examples of each one and showing it to me. I was absolutely mesmerized. What could you say? I didn't want to interrupt him because it was going so well. I don't know how long I stayed there. I don't know if it was 2 minutes or 10 minutes. But I listened to Skippy talk about this product that almost nobody would want to talk about for a long time. And I realized, man, this guy has got it down. So up until that point in my life, and I admit at no time after, did I ever really have a need for a bottle of deer urine? But I couldn't leave without getting something. I mean... I'm pretty sure I threw it away at the hotel because I didn't want to think about what would happen in the back of the 172 if it kind of popped open, but I bought it because Skippy did such a great job. And I was smiling at this point. I was really happy because, oh my God, here's somebody who really knows how to sell something. Features, benefits, examples, you know, asking me questions, interactive. So I go to the checkout counter and there's a woman who's obviously worked there a really long time. And I'm sort of giggling and smirking like I am now because I do that a lot. And she goes, how are you doing today? I was surprised she didn't ask me if I found everything that I needed. I said, how are you doing today? I said, I'm having a great time. And she looked at me and says, really? I guess a lot of people don't have a good time at that store. So I said, no, really. And then she's not saying anything. And she's just staring at me like, you know, that 1,000-yard stare. And I thought I had to say something. And I said, yeah, I've never been in a store that had a combination couch and love seat all in camouflage, because there was one right there at the checkout counter. And I said, you sell a lot of those? Okay, thinking this would turn the tide and we'd finish the checkout process. And she goes, oh yeah, we sold one of those yesterday. And I swear to God, I didn't mean to say it because as Jerry said, I didn't have a filter. I said, really? What'd they look like? 1,000-yard stare again. For you guys who are close to the cliff, I want to assure you, okay, this is a little hint just for me to you. Nowhere do the words camouflage and love seat go together, okay? In no circumstance whatsoever is that going to work for you when the truck arrives at your house. I'm just saying, okay? So I run out of the store, but I said, if Skippy can sell deer urine, maybe we can teach flight instructors how to do a better job at customer service. So we started doing that. And the things we're talking about, and we can't talk about them all today for a couple reasons. One, I only have a short time. Two, we're running a little bit late, and I don't want to get between you and the bathroom, as I said. But we talk about first contact, how you handle those calls, selling your flight school, selling the equipment you have at the flight school, selling the simulations, selling the programs that you have at the flight school, and of course, selling your services as a flight instructor and why this is going to be the best place to train. We talk about dealing with regression and handling AAA personalities like all of us have and building that PIC ship and stick and rudder skills at the same time we're doing automation management, all that kind of stuff we talk about in terms of their customer service. As a way of talking about this, first contact, I called 8 flight schools before I came, before I did this presentation. I called them on Friday. Some of them were yours. And I asked a question. I said, hey, I'm a commercial helicopter pilot. I got about 500 hours, and I'm thinking about getting a 172 so I can commute to the Gulf, you know, for my job. What's it going to take for me to get a private pilot certificate in an airplane? Can you tell me that? Can you tell me that? Can you tell me that? And the survey results are, one of the schools didn't answer the phone, didn't leave a message either. 3 said they would have someone call me back, only one of those did. In Texas, they would say, this is your problem right here. And except for one person out of the 8, all of them assured me it would be the FAA minimums of 40 hours. Now, one of those people did say, well, they were 141, so it would be 35 hours, but they can't do it under 141 because it's an additional rating, and you can't do that under 141. I said, okay, that's good to know. All of these people could use some first contact training. So you need to ask yourself, if customer service is at the core of your business, and your instructors are the front line of your customer service, if they don't do these things well, they suck. Let's talk about technical competence. 20-25% of the applicants showing up for flight tests with me could never start the test because they weren't qualified to begin the test. Let me say that again. Nearly a quarter of the people who would show up for flight tests with me, we couldn't start the test because they didn't meet the basic FAR requirements. So I said, I know what I can do. I'll start a FERC. So we teach instructors what those requirements are. We get them up to speed. We'll do a little customer service training. We'll do some first contact training. We'll get all those ideas together. But mostly, we'll get their technical competence up to speed. We did that, and I did that over about 3 years, did about 500 people. And as part of this FERC, we did a pretest. And the pretest on the subject was just to focus them on the subjects because, as you know, all us pilots and flight instructors have the attention span of a gnat. So if we can focus on a little pretest, and it didn't count, by the way, just focus on the pretest. Now we're thinking about this topic. We can then go on to get a little more deep into the material. Okay. About 8% failed the pretest. Oh, wait. I got to change that slide. About 8% passed the pretest. And we're talking about basic stuff now. What an eye-opener for me. I thought this was going to be a top-level refresher. It was really a start from the bottom, go to the ground up, way to try and get people in 2 days of comedy flying school up to speed on some of the basics. I'll give you another example. I do initial CFI tests as well. My experience has been that the CFI technical knowledge is, to say the least, poor. And I'm being as kind as I can possibly be, even with my version of aviation Tourette's that Jerry talked about. I'll give you some examples of that. First, as warm-up questions, I ask the people when we're talking about fundamentals of instruction now, and there's a question about intensity. And I say, okay, what's the FAA mean by intensity? Now, I know you're not supposed to ask, if anybody here from the FAA? Anybody here from the FAA? Anybody here from the FAA? Should have found that out ahead of time. Okay, I'm not supposed to ask rote questions like, what does the FAA mean by intensity, right? But sometimes you need some warm-up questions. I learned this from one of the very first designated pilot examiners, and we're going to see him at work right here. Josh, this is where we'll...
Sir Lancelot of Camelot, what is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is your favorite color?
Blue.
Right, off you go.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much.
That's easy! Who approacheth the bridge of death must answer me these questions 3. The other side he see.
Ask me the questions, Bridgekeeper. I'm not afraid.
What is your name?
Sir Robin of Camelot.
What is your quest?
To seek the Holy Grail.
What is the capital of Assyria?
I don't know that.
What do you mean by intensity?
No, it was... It's one of my heroes, by the way. Okay, the answer, right? Typically, being a warm-up question like, what's your favorite color? Most people get it right. One person recently actually said to me, you know, it's when something is really intense, dude. Oh, I can't make this crap up. I just can't, I couldn't do it. You know that 82% of the people voting in the presidential election are not voting for the candidate because they like that candidate, they're voting against the other candidate. Did you know that? 82%. Oops. I don't know what I did. Josh will fix it. 82%. You know where I got that number? I made it up, like everybody else does. Okay. So, this guy says, you know, it's really intense, dude. Now, my outside voice, my examiner voice is, okay, would you like to expand on that a little bit? No, more? Oh, no, that didn't work. Okay, we'll move on and we'll come back to that a little bit later. Of course, my inside voice is going, I can't believe you just said that, okay? One, dude, don't call me dude. My generation invented dude. You just can't hijack the word and use it against me. I don't know when we invented it. It was a long time ago when I was in school learning, don't use an adjective that is the same word to describe the noun I'm trying to get the answer to. But I don't. Okay, we'll move on. I'll give you another example of stuff. One of the questions that I ask that isn't rote is, tell me how you will help learners develop long-term memory of important items. In other words, there is a question in the FOI about going from short-term memory to long-term memory. I know you don't remember that, but it is, okay? And I ask this question, and most of the time, I get that same look that cashier gave me. And it goes on for a while. And I'm quiet, I'm waiting, I'm doing something else in my head at the time. And time goes by, and the Jeopardy clock is going off in their head, and eventually they shout at anything. So now I'm asking a question, and I find this ironic. I'm asking a question about memory, and the number one answer that I get after about 30 seconds is, can you repeat the question? It's not just bad because they don't know the answer to the question. It's bad because they don't know how to handle not knowing the answer to the question. They haven't been trained on how to deal with an oral evaluation. So if they're not trained, how well do you think your applicants are going to be trained? I don't understand that in 2016 that they don't know how to duck a question, because certainly the two presidential candidates have shiny examples. I'm not going to mention which one, but one of the presidential candidates was asked, well, you know, there's been discussion about how foreign governments paid donations to your foundation in order to get access to the State Department, and the answer was, it was beautiful. I'm glad you brought up my foundation. This foundation has done tens of millions of dollars of work helping people all over the world. It goes on for about 30 seconds, and I'm going, that wasn't the question. But was it a good job? It was an excellent job of sidestepping the question, and we can't even teach people how to do that. All you gotta do is watch the news. So, my point is here, if applicants continue to have large gaps in their knowledge, guess what? Your flight instructors suck. And you got to do something about it. Why? Okay. What I'm going to do, I started going VFR direct to the applicants because trying to get it filtered through the instructors who are, like I said, touch and go employees with very different motivations than you have. So I wrote the book, 20 Ways to Fail Your Flight Test, the other 9 questions, FARs for people who actually might need to know them. And, of course, I'm finishing one that says, why you suck as a flight instructor. It's not about you, but it is. Okay. Those will probably be available all on Amazon by Christmas. Somebody asked me when they were coming out, and I had to admit, it takes an unusually long amount of time to publish a book when you just keep dragging your feet and not doing it. So, but all the little pieces are in place, and we'll do it. That's what I'll do for you. For your part, there's good news. You're going to have these flight instructors a little bit longer because now the airlines have to, everybody has to have an ATP before they move into the right seat. The bad news is, of course, you're going to have these people a little longer. So they are going to have a huge, huge impact on your success. Or should I say, huge, huge impact on your success. The biggest impact ever, I'm just saying. And you say to yourself, so what? You know, is this a waste of time? Is it good enough? And of course, the real question you have to ask yourself, if the bar is this low, how good do they have to be for me to be better than the guy next door? I don't really know. That's a question for you guys to answer. They're your schools. But I'll give you the so what. So what if your instructors got a little better at their job? And by the way, those resources are out there. You know, if you pay my way and let me fly, I'll come and talk to them. The reason, by the way, that I've talked at every migration is I don't charge anything, and all I want is lunch. So it works out. But if you can just get a 10% increase in your customer satisfaction, that's going to turn into increased profits for you. There's no doubt about it. You know it's going to happen. So is that worth it to you? I thought I had some more. There it is. Is that worth to you? Well, I have a suggestion. Maybe your instructors are all top-notch. I don't know. You know, hopefully they are. Maybe they suck. I don't know. Hopefully they don't. But if you assume that that certificate that they have in their wallet creates any kind of competency about customer service skills or technical knowledge, well, your thinking may be just a touch sophomoric. All right. Some closing thoughts. Those were the reasons your flight instructors might suck. I have my own reasons about why I suck as a flight instructor, but that would take twice as long in the presentation for me to go through those. I just want to clean up two last points. Intensity. It's when you use all your senses to deliver the point. Sight, sound, touch, etc. Okay? And how do you turn short-term memory into long-term memory? You do it by intensity, association, application, practice, practice again. And if you want the bonus answer that will get you through the entire question, use the effing syllabus. It ain't no rocket surgery. I'm just saying. That's all I got.